I was looking for a transition. I was looking to do something more. I'd realized that the time I had a few single family houses under my belt and, you know, managing them on my own and learning that side of the business. But, realizing that scaling at that point was going to take some time and effort and, some considerable income. So, you know, my next route was looking at multifamily. Scalability is the main concern. You know, from a property management standpoint, I felt like, for me anyways, I needed to jump into that world. I needed to understand my tenants. I need to understand how that world worked from a property management standpoint. So for me, it was more learning, education, growing, moving into the multifamily space. And again, you know, moving primarily all my business to Kurt and, you know, on the property management side has been an adjustment, for sure. But, it's given me back, you know, a lot of my time to work into other type investments.
This episode brought to you by Suites at Madison. Meeting and conference rooms for rent by the hour, week, month, or year. Suites at Madison, where business gets done. Check them out at www.downtowntampaoffice.com. Now on to the show.
You are listening to the Invest Florida Real Estate Show, covering topics in lending, buy and sell strategies, property management, hot markets, and tips and tools to guide you along the way on your path to real estate success. You want Florida investment real estate talk? You have come to the right place. And now, our hosts, Eric Odom and Steven Silverman.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Invest Florida Real Estate Show. This is your co-host, Eric Odom, along with Steven Silverman, fresh off the boat, or rather the plane from Las Vegas, where you had officially abandoned me and left me to do all of your chores for how long?
Eric, I needed a break, but I came back. You were as fit as a fiddle. It was only 3 days.
Yeah.
You know, I went out. They had an exhibition there, the self-storage show. I wanted to see what was going on over there and learn what was going on in the market. Everywhere we look throughout Florida, we're seeing more development. What I did learn is that, you know, frankly, the self-storage permits crested in 2017. But since then, development has slowed dramatically. But just in a smaller market like Tampa, there's 14 new units, 14 self-storage units coming up. That's 1.2 million square feet.
Now, the reason you went to this show was because your family owns some multifamily, correct?
Well, no, they have some, you know, we have partners and we have some self-storage. So I just wanted to see what was going on and stay and make sure that we keep current.
Sure.
And, you know, we have some responsibility for.
And you actually do some of the management on that, but that's not really anything that we engage in. And I think it's, you know, it's safe to say that the multifamily and the self storage is really not the Florida investment real estate's area of expertise in terms from a management standpoint.
When we manage, because both of them are really different worlds. They each their own microcosm with their own systems. And in multifamily, taking care of tenants who suddenly have a problem is a whole different
set of effects. We have to have the systems set up. I mean, for us, we do a lot of retail management, some office, but retail is really our bread and butter, and that's what we're set up to handle. You know, multifamily and self-storage requires a different skill set, and we really prefer just to stay in our lane. Obviously, we have investors that come around from all over the world that ask us about retail properties and some office, and they ask us to manage it, and there's no problem with that. But, you know, for investors that maybe manage multifamily, curious about getting into self-storage, it's just a different deal. I mean, it requires more, it's more labor intensive.
But what is interesting to see how the markets work together. We've seen here the incredible increase in multifamily development, and really self-storage feeds off that. So that's why you're seeing all these new self-storage developments coming. It tracks very closely to multifamily.
Yeah, and we do some brokerage on the multifamily side and the self-storage side, but just don't manage it. Wanted to get into our guest in a minute. Another multifamily episode, very interesting topic today with folks that are, we have a repeat guest who's brought back one of his clients and partners to talk about their deal, and we'll get into that in just a moment. Wanted to take the time to read a review from Sandra$04, who took the time to go to the iTunes store and leave a review for about Brian Chavez show. And she says, amazing show. Appreciate his honesty and openness. Sandra, so thankful that you went on to the iTunes store and left us a review. Anybody who would do the same will definitely take the time to read the review on air. It's very meaningful for us. And so it's much appreciated that you take the time and leave us a review. It does let potential guests know that we are here and alive and the investors are listening to the show. Everybody wants to know that their time is well invested. And if they see reviews and people interacting with us, then that's meaningful in us to attract great guests. So Sandra, again, thank you so much for your time there. Now, Stephen, is there anything else we want to talk about prior to rolling with our guest today?
I want to roll with the guests. Let's go. We have with us today Double Trouble. First is Kurt Westfield. Kurt is an expert real estate investor who serves on Dreamstone Advisory Board. He has personally invested over $19 million in over 700 residential and multifamily units since 2009, and he continues to actively invest in apartment communities. Kurt, through his company Blue Peak Realty, provides property management services to over 200 units and is well positioned to handle all aspects of multifamily and commercial assets. Second, we have sitting next to me John King. John King is a native of Canada, and he is a true hockey fan. And I also learned when he was testing the microphone that he was also in a rock band, so he's pretty familiar with that hardware. His full-time job is in talent acquisition at Deloitte, and he does part-time real estate. He began by flipping real estate single-family properties from 2007 to 2013 and built his capital. Not long after, he met Kurt Westfield. And that's a story by itself. And together they entered into the multifamily space. And John is now pursuing that journey in the multifamily world. So Kurt and John, welcome to the Invest Florida show.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you guys.
No, really appreciate you guys investing your time with us. I know Kurt was on the show previously. And I mean, it's probably been a couple of years, hasn't it been, Kurt?
You know, these days they tend to get away from me, so I'm not sure quite how long it's been.
January 2017.
January.
Boom, there you go.
There you go. So it's been a year, early last year.
So maybe a bit over a year, Eric. Not quite 2 years.
Well, John chimed in. He obviously knows this story for some reason. So go ahead, John. Tell us the story.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, thanks for having me, guys. So I came across Kurt on your show here. About a year ago. And, you know, I think what resonated with me at the time was I was looking for a transition. I was looking to do something more. I'd realized that the time I had a few single family houses under my belt and, you know, managing them on my own and learning that side of the business. But, realizing that scaling at that point was going to take some time and effort and, some considerable income. So, you know, my next route was looking at multifamily, and that's where, you know, I came across Kurt on your podcast and really resonated with me in terms of the interview and just his energy and the whole story, I think, resonated. So that's why I decided to reach out. And
so, you know, that really warms my heart, because you were both independent listeners of the Invest Florida show, and you got together and went off and pursued a direction. And that makes Eric and I feel really good, because we enjoy the guests that we get, and we learn so much. And when they get together, or when people call in and they tell us the deals they did with one another, and it happens, it just shows that it really pays off to sit back and learn sometimes. So kudos to both of you for doing that.
Now, Kurt, tell us a little bit about what you're up to, and you know what you kind of felt. Now, obviously, you guys made a connection. You and John made a connection. And so, like, what were you doing and that you're working on and that John approached you on that sort of made sense for you guys to work together?
Sure. Well, when John initially reached out, you know, just like any other kind of cold client contact, whether it comes from a listing or from a referral or or from an article, or in this case, from the podcast. You know, I wanted to see initially what I could do to immediately help, or what my office could do to help, what his goals were, you know, vet him out, flesh him out a little bit, find out if it was truly something that we would have some synergy on, or if it was, you know, something that I couldn't really immediately or personally help with, but could kind of refer him out in the office to someone else. And, you know, he had a ton of energy. He was incredibly prepared. I think he had a binder put together of his properties, photos, P&Ls on everything. And so I knew that he had his stuff together, and he had mentioned wanting to kind of upleg into multifamily, into that space. So we met in the office. We looked over his portfolio, and he had a really a broad spectrum of single family homes and townhomes throughout Tampa. He had some in South Tampa, some in Seminole Heights. He had some Class A, Class B, Class C. So very well diversified in that specific region. He had owned some of these 1-2+ years, to more recently properties he had purchased to flip and or to hold, and then came across the podcast. And I think that's where the lightning, that's where the lightning bolt hit. So we met, we kind of discussed pricing. I think some of the pricing on some of his properties surprised him. Surely the market has been very healthy.
And pricing in terms of the how much the value of each one of his units are, is that what you're talking about with pricing?
Correct. Yep. Sorry. So let me back up on that. So what we had discussed was, in order to jump from the single family to the multifamily sphere, he was interested in and okay with liquidating his single family portfolio entirely and rotating that capital into multifamily. So we listed these both individually and as a portfolio as a whole, and started selling them off piece by piece. And as the properties started selling, before they started selling, I think he was interested in, you know, what price point could we get for all five of these homes, five or six of these homes, and then what could we roll that over into, you know, both a number of units in multifamily and NOI, you know, how could we make this a stronger play, you know, based on the equity they had, you know, the current rate of return he was getting. You know, mind you, he was self-managing. So if he was also going to go into other markets and a larger number of doors, you know, we had discussed extracting him from the, you know, the day-to-day management role. So we want to cover that cost as well. So as we started selling these, he started buying multis. He started doing some value add deals. We started leasing the units, and it's really just come full circle. And it's been very exciting. Been a great, great accomplishment of his. And really, it's just getting started. He's under contract for some bigger projects. And I'm sure he'll mention shortly, he's actually partnered with some other colleagues, and they're starting a syndicated fund to do much of the same.
So, Kurt, what is the structure, or John, I mean, why don't we ask John this question? John, what's the structure of your relationship with Kurt? Like, are you guys set up in a syndication, or is it a partnership relationship, or what is it that, how are you guys working together? The legal structure.
Yeah, right now, you know, Kurt's acting as acquisition lead. So, you know, he's helping me source deals, but he's also helping me, you know, liquidate my current rental property that I have here in Tampa. So, you know, he's acting on both sides there.
So he's acting as a partner.
Yeah. John knows everything. John owns everything individually through his LLC. Our office is simply acting in a brokerage capacity, okay, and a property management capacity. So there's no sharing or partnership with regards to assets on these specific deals. John owns all of them outright, and we're simply managing them and partnered with him in that capacity.
So, John, I'd like to ask you a question. You have a unique perspective now, because you were accustomed to running things in single family and a certain type of yield, and now you're involved in the multifamily space, and you've got property management. So I'm assuming your workload is a lot lighter. How are you finding your returns on investment or your yields in your new multifamily as opposed to the single family.
And also, I want to add some dimension to that. I kind of also want to know the evolution of where you came from and your thoughts to where you're going now. Because Steven's asking some very specific investment related, but I'd like to, you know, kind of roll into that by first trying to understand your mentality going from where you came to where you're going now. Like, what are you trying to achieve?
Yeah, what made you unhappy with being in the single family space and that you felt the need to transition? And then what do you see as the results?
From a single family perspective, I think scalability is the main concern. You know, from a property management standpoint, I felt like, for me anyways, I needed to jump into that world. I needed to understand my tenants. I need to understand how that world worked from a property management standpoint. So for me, it was more learning, education, growing, moving into the multifamily space. And again, you know, moving primarily all my business to Kurt and, you know, on the property management side has been an adjustment, for sure. But, it's given me back, you know, a lot of my time to work into other type investments, in particular the syndicated deal that I'm working on with, two other investors here in Tampa.
So it was really about trying to, it sounds like, if I can put words in your mouth, that you're creating some leverage for yourself. That you're going to be operating or moving into sort of that asset manager role and using other people's money along with your own to invest and buy. Is that a fair assessment?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a fair assessment. Yeah.
Okay. So tell us a little bit about the investment fund. Like, I don't need to know specifics about it, but sort of just a general idea of like what you're wanting to accomplish with that and how that fits into your goals.
Yeah, absolutely. The fund that we've created, actually, the LLC is called Dreamstone Investments. We're based out of Tampa here. Actually met up with two investors here local. One is actually working with Kurt also, who I referred. So this all comes full circle in one way or another.
Sure. Yeah.
But essentially what we're trying to do is create a syndicated fund with like-minded individuals and investors here in Tampa and abroad. We're looking at multifamily at this point, but open to other areas of investment too.
And they really have a phenomenal structure, if I might butt in there. When I met with the three of them, certainly John taking the lead, and you know, a little bit about, he elaborated on the scalability. You know, he does own several multifamily properties individually, and I don't think that will change. That will certainly continue to grow. He'll continue to grow his own portfolio. But for purposes of how Eric mentioned, to leverage his time and leverage his investability, him and these two other investors have created this fund, and they really have a very unique makeup in the team that they are. One, of course, being John, certainly has the investment experience over the last 10 plus years of fixing and flipping and leasing and managing. Another, Nick, is a construction manager and has great insight as to appraisal values, insurance values, cost of construction, etc. And then the third partner is actually a CPA. And so together they create this kind of superhero team of real estate investors. And I'm very excited and intrigued to see how Dreamstone grows separate from John's own investments.
Yeah, that's a really cool syndication concept. So let me go back and just ask John the question, like looking back in your rearview mirror, how, and aside from the time and everything else, just from investment performance, how does the single family homes rate in comparison to the or compare with the multifamily for you as an investor?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, the multifamily for me so far has I think been you know, twofold. You know, number one, it's provided me the access to more doors, you know, and not having to put down you know, similar type of you know, down payment. So you know, the second part to it is obviously, you know, being able to scale. And so for me, that's been the best part. For the single family, you know, it's been a great education, great learning experience. But for me, I see myself doing bigger things and growing my portfolio in different ways from multifamily.
Let me just ask about your syndication, Dreamstone, and sort of the genesis of that, Nick, and I'm sorry, I forgot. There's a CPA. What's his name? CPA?
Vihano.
So Vihano.
South African.
South African. Okay.
He is, yes.
Oh, gosh, you got Stephen all excited. So excited.
I knew Stephen would love that.
He dropped the mic. He's speechless.
So you guys might never get out of there.
Yeah. Let's move past the South African thing really quickly. CPA and a construction guy. And how did you guys meet? Was it your idea to sort of bring this syndication together as a team, and then you put the pieces together? And then finally, where are you going to raise funds for this this venture?
So, yeah, good question. Vihano is a friend of mine that I've known for a couple of years from mutual friends in Tampa. He was interested in creating wealth outside of his daily, business. So, we started discussing one night about, investment opportunities and in particular,
Hang on, I think that's the first time you said about. So say
I'll be saying about a few times here. Okay, just to keep it interesting. Yeah. So we got together on a few different topics, but real estate investing was something that he really sort of took hold on in terms of our conversation. So, I introduced him to Kurt. From there, they went out and found their first deal, which I think they closed on last week.
Okay.
So, he's new into the space now. But the idea of the syndication and going bigger, going larger, has really struck home, I think, with Vihano and myself. So, we went out looking for additional members who may want to be part of this, add value to our group. And that's where we came across Nick. Nick has years of experience under construction management, property management. Nick was a mutual friend of somebody else. So just kind of came full circle from there and, met with them instantly, liked the guy, and decided to bring him in. And, this is all within the last 4 weeks, I would say, this whole group. So from that time, we've, created this new LLC, and we're just sort of getting underway at this point. So, we, in terms of investors and having deals under contract, that's something to be determined. But I think from a process orientation standpoint, we've really taken hold of where we want to go and what we want to do. We've set our sights on certain aspirations and sticking to timelines and going from there.
We had a little conversation before this started about how people always want to do these things and somehow the momentum to do it never comes. And we spoke about you just have to jump into the fire and make it happen. And you have to figure out ways to transition to make your goals happen. And, you're doing it. It's really cool to see you branch out and then go off into this new direction.
So where are you raising? Where are you raising money from? This for the last part of the question. So, obviously, you're contributing quite a bit. Are your partners contributing too? Are you going into through the broker dealer network, or are you have you got a path in terms of how the people you're targeting that would be financial partners with you? How's that look, John?
Yeah, right now we're in a position where we're not actively looking to invest ourselves. We want to keep that separate from our own portfolios and investments.
Okay.
So at this time, looking at friends and family, colleagues, coworkers, we all have a large network individually. I think in and out of the real estate industry. So myself being a recruiter for large corporations such as Deloitte, Price Waterhouse, these are all active firms that of individuals that I'm able to target and look for, as well as Vihano being a CPA. So there's a large network out there of individuals that we plan to look at.
So John, what are your goals in terms of where you want to go? You started with single family, you went to multifamily, and you said you might be open to other things. Just from a 30,000 foot view, what are your investment criteria? Where would you like to see this going? What are you looking for?
Yeah, so your specific deal structure in terms of the deal that works for you guys.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, for me in particular, and like many, you know, investors in the multifamily space, you know, I'm looking for anywhere in between a C and B class neighborhood. You know, rents anywhere between $800 to $1,200, I think. You know, anything that's really considered recession proof.
In Florida,
absolutely. Yeah. Florida, right now, we've looked in Tampa. I think moving outside of Tampa, looking at Jacksonville for me is particularly of interest. You know, being number five fastest growing economy right now in the US, Florida being, you know, having a huge influx of, new migration and people moving down here for various reasons. Jacksonville just makes sense. And Kurt also being established there already. You know, that definitely helps out. So, you know, those are some of the criteria that I look for.
Okay. So it's value add. You're looking for value add deals.
100% value add.
And so what are some of those like things that really perk your ears up? Is it, you know, improving the bathrooms? Is it improving parking and dog walks? Or what are some of those things that really perk your ears up when you hear, oh gosh, that could be that's something I want to pay attention to?
Yeah. I mean, I'll give an example of, the duplex we purchased, 2 months ago in Jacksonville. You know, it was a non-occupied. So, we'd gone in and, you know, touched up the paint. You know, worked around, the yard, you know, just basic things like that, basic value add. I think it was a bright, ugly, bright blue, really nasty color you didn't want to see on anybody or Senemi's house. But, we went in and made it, you know, look presentable and, you know, nothing structurally wrong, with the, property. The roof was in sound condition, but we added new AC units, and, touched up the flooring, touched up the kitchens, stainless steel, just to make it pop, and really add the value that way.
Okay, I saw you mentioned the ugly blue, and I saw you look down, and I thought you were looking at Steven's shoes to see if he was wearing his blue shoes that he likes to wear, but apparently he's got
he was the rock star with blue suede shoes. But
So, John, how many units, as small as duplex and as large as, like, fill in the blank? What does that look like?
In terms of where I'm at now or where I want to go?
Yep.
You know, that's a great question as far as, you know, I can take myself and as far as I see myself going right now, it's a step by step. So, you know, I do things in stages. I like to get comfortable with where I'm going and, just looking at it from a deal perspective, and assessing risk management. So, you know, we've worked on a duplex. We've closed on a quadplex, right now under contract. We've got an eightplex. So it seems like everything's happening in twos.
Yeah. Now, Kurt, you tend to deal and this is where I can guarantee this is where some of the experience that you can lend to John, dealing in larger units, 20 plus units, correct?
Yeah. I mean, we do deal in 20 plus, but that's still that niche of 2 to 20, the small residential multifamily. You know, we've been catering to that crowd for years and years.
Okay.
And it seems to be, a very popular, investment, especially for someone exactly like John, who went from single family to multifamily. You know, just the integers he mentioned, he went from 1 to 2, 2 to 4, 4 to now 8. And you know, someone like him that gets very comfortable with the process before uplegging to another level, I think, is key. It's key to be conservative and not jump around all over the place, not be, you know, a jack of all trades. I think he'll get very comfortable in that 8 to 12 unit range. And then at that point, assess the growth of the portfolio and then begin in the 20 to 30 unit range. And, you know, anytime you're talking 30 plus units under one roof, you know, you're pretty well built a strong, multifamily portfolio that's going to allow you a lot of other wealth building avenues and leverage and growth. And so I think, you know, a couple of years ago, having, you know, the largest property he had was a single family home to now, you know, being an 8-unit apartment building. I think there's great structure and great synergy and great growth for him. And I'm happy to see it occurring, you know, at equal levels and proceed very safely.
Okay. So you're helping now with the acquisition. So let's talk a little bit about what you're doing. What avenues are you going down to help them find the deals that are going to meet their criteria.
Well, just before you answer that question, because this is a lead into it, you live and breathe in the multifamily market, and you know we've got so much new multifamily construction coming, but the preponderance seems to be Class A. How do you feel about which is in the economy, which is the right space to go and invest, where you're likely to be safest or have the best returns?
Well, the best returns I do still strongly feel are going to be in that B and C region. The Class A properties, really from a sex appeal standpoint, are great, but that's really only wealth preservation. There's not really much growth going on there at a 4 or 5 or 6% cap. Institutional buyers that are exchanging properties can get into those units, but the price per unit alone, you know, the location, either super urban core or waterfront, you know, those items tend to be a hindrance to investors that have limited capital or are looking to radically grow their portfolio. So I would always recommend avoiding Class A unless you can find a true value add, you know, unicorn type of deal that allows you to get into that high barrier to entry region, but still build strong value and generate a strong return. For most people, like John, a 5% return is just not feasible.
So then, just to answer Eric's question, what strategies are you pursuing to help John find properties and build his portfolio?
So with John specifically, he was looking for value add types of deals, high vacancy or full vacancy, distressed, foreclosure. Any type of deal that he could bring immediate value to, we could add immediate renovation to fill the vacancies, strategic leasing, bring those rents up and get that property functioning and cash flowing to a point conservatively that I thought when it was occupied, could he sell it for more that day than the cost of purchase plus renovation? And that was always, you know, the conservative goal. And if that rate of return happened to be north of 12, 13, 15%, then it was a conservative, low risk, winning property for him to add to his portfolio. So we started looking in the Jacksonville market. We also operate there as well and manage many, many units there. And, you know, the uniqueness and the ability to be a property manager and to also operate in those spaces gives buyers the ability to feed on unlisted properties. You know, because we manage so many properties, you know, all of those properties, any investor will tell you every property is always for sale at any time. Just the price has to be right. So for him, those properties didn't really fit because they're occupied and turnkey and operational. He wanted vacant, you know, high value add, you know, that type of deal structure. So we also send out thousands of mailers monthly, and we came across some distressed deals that fit perfectly for him. So he bought those. Our construction management team handled all of the renovations, got everything leased, and just have kept that process up. And you know, the value add tend to be higher risk because of the amount of capital and attention to detail and you know, code compliance and leasing that goes into that type of structure. So the 8 unit he's looking at is fully occupied. I think 7 or 8 or 8 of 8 occupied, more of a turnkey product in what I would deem the Seminole Heights of Jacksonville type of market. So a gentrifying, strong, historic region.
And what market is that,
together,
Kurt?
Go ahead.
Kurt, what market is that, Kurt, for our Jacksonville listeners?
Springfield.
Springfield, okay.
Yep. So, you know, local listeners in Jacksonville will recognize the Springfield region. And, you know, it's got the bungalows, it's got the history, it's got the businesses, the breweries, the bars, the bike paths for you, Eric.
And,
so,
and what kind of caps are you seeing there that you think is a good investment in today's market?
I think on his 2 and 4 units, and I don't have his data in front of me, but I think he's well north of 12 or 15% there in those deals.
Okay. And so if I hear you properly, you're going out and doing a lot of prospecting, and you're prospecting in your business anywhere and you're in the market. So this is where you're providing some value add for John. Are you also going through the broker network or your banking network to try to find deals as well? Is there any other sort of tools that you have in the tool bag to try to find deals? We all know that deals are the hardest part of this job.
Sure. Yeah. Deal making and deal acquisition at this inning of the game becomes more and more valuable. The foreclosure market is pretty well absorbed. Those have always been phenomenal deals for the most part for an investor that's able to take on, that has the appetite for that type of property. For John, we're always plugged in. We're always looking. Obviously, we're well connected to the MLS on a real-time daily basis. His deals didn't come from there, but that's not always a bad place to start. High days on market, there's not always, once you get into that 2 to 4 unit multifamily, the traditional cookie cutter real estate agent sometimes doesn't know how to properly market those deals. They're so used to the single family spectrum. And so you can sometimes still find deals that are inadequately marketed. Sometimes the bed bath count is wrong. Sometimes the NOI calculation in the listing is wrong. And so you can find better deals than are actually advertised. Obviously, resourcing through CoStar, LoopNet, broker relationships, and things of that nature, in addition to the units that we manage and the sellers and owners that we manage for, all of that, that entire ecosystem is always fluid and moving. And, John will at one point be a seller to a buyer, and that transaction will likely happen, off record, unlisted. And so, that's actually how this 8-unit transaction occurred. This was not a listed deal. This was an out of town owner. John loved the property. We pitched a low price and he was able to get it done. So, those types of deals happen, and they happen with the more people you have in your network. And, I'm glad that that him and I have connected and that we're working through everything together.
Awesome.
So before we wrap up, let me ask John one more question. You're on your new path. Where do you want to be in 2 years' time? And
5 years, yeah. What's your door count number? You have an idea of like where it starts making real sense for you, where you want to go?
Door count, no. But scaling is definitely a priority of mine. I do have a certain number in mind that I would like in order to being able to leverage more of my time into investment real estate. So I think that's more of the goal at this point for me, is hitting that number and achieving that number. And I have a yearly number that I'd like to achieve. So I can give that example of what it is, but we're on track to achieving that number, thanks to Kurt and his team this year. So
can you talk about it?
Yeah. I mean, my number last year was, 2,500. I wanted to double that this year. So we're on track to achieve 5,000 monthly, passive income this year. And then from there, we'll look at 75 and then beyond from there. So
awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. Hey, man, really appreciate the time that you invested with us today. And Kurt, likewise, Kurt is a retread. He's been on the show before. Kurt's always a wealth of information on the multifamily side, and we certainly appreciate your time as well, Kurt. So, guys, thank you so much for your time today.
And, guys, just, we'll close the mics, but, we still have the mic in John's hand, so we're going to go back to some of that heavy metal stuff that he did before he ever got started in real estate. And we'll let you know how it goes. John, thanks so much for being with us. Kurt, also a pleasure to have you again, and we look forward to seeing how your new ventures progress.
Really appreciate it, guys. Thank you so much.
Actually, I've got one more question before we leave, and that's, the Tampa Bay Lightning is a number one seed. So what's the prognostication for the Lightning moving forward in the playoffs?
All the way. That's what I'm predicting. All the way. They've had an excellent run, even better management. And I'm a huge Stevie Y fan growing up in Canada, not too far from Detroit. So, always good to see some hometown boys, even though they're across the pond. Awesome. Representing our team here in Tampa. But
awesome. Yeah. So you're able to make a lot of games?
I go to as many as I can, absolutely. And a few of the players, actually, I used to play growing up quite a bit. A few of the players on the team, Stamkos, Johnson, played for rival teams that I played for up in Canada. So,
wow.
Very interesting to see them now at the big leagues.
Yeah, Stamkos, he's not bad.
Absolutely, yeah.
All right, guys. Thank you so much.
Thanks, guys.
And that was John King and Kurt Westfield. Awesome discussion with those guys. Steven, what were your thoughts?
Eric, I have to tell you, for me, that was a very important podcast, because for me, it was validation. You know, what we want to have is a community. We don't monetize the podcast. We do it for fun. And every week we learn from people and we get some amazing people on the show, and having a community where people can meet each other and go on to better things. John transitioned from single family to multifamily, and one of the steps he did that was because of the podcast. So I was very happy with that, and I think it's, you know, he's very methodical in taking the steps. He's identified his goals and he's getting there in due course, but he's getting there, and the show played a part in that.
Yeah, no, it's, and they're not the only ones who have made matches on the show. A lot of our guests, part of the reason that they come on is they want to network with the listeners. And it could be anybody from the contractors to the investors to the deal makers that are looking for partners to engage on their business. And so congratulations to Kurt and John on finding each other and helping to both make the pie a little bit larger by collaborating and partnering on some multifamily deals. Steven, great guest, great topic. Any place that people can go find other guests that might be able to help them make some money?
You know, funny that you mentioned that. There are a few places. You know, one of the best places to go is to go and download the app and listen while you're mobile. The Invest Florida Show, you can get it on iTunes, on Google, on Stitcher, and listen while you're in the gym or driving.
You can't forget the InvestFloridaShow.com.
The website.
You can find those apps right there without having to dig around. And there are links there for you to be able to download the app and enjoy the other episodes and hopefully make some money out of networking with other speakers, other guests. So, Steven, anything else before we let our listeners go?
We're going to let them go. So good luck, and hope you find your dreams like Johnny's.
Guys, until next time, hasta la vista.
You've just listened to the Invest Florida podcast with Eric Odom and Steven Silverman. Join us every week for actionable real estate investment ideas, and of course, visit our website at www.investfloridashow.com for more shows and tips on how to earn a cash flow in the real estate market in Florida. While hosts and producers of the Invest Florida Show have no reason to doubt the validity of comments of our guests, we do not warranty their accuracy. Please check with your legal, financial, and tax advisors before entering into any investment. Returns will vary from person to person and deal to deal based on unique circumstances. All information expressed in this show is for educational purposes only. Opinions of the guests are not necessarily shared by the hosts and producers of the Invest Florida Show.